Setting up a ZFS pool requires a number of permanent decisions that will affect the performance, cost, and reliability of your NAS. So you really need to understand some, if not all, the options available to you for making the right choices at the beginning. On the other hand, if you get it wrong, you have no choice but to destroy your Z pools and start again. Make sure you take the data backup first. So the first question you should be asking is, do you need performance or do you need capacity? In my case, I wanted both. And it all depends on what type of data you'll be storing. Do you just need to save some personal files, family videos or pictures? Or will you be running some databases and VMs? So I had 5 enterprise SSDs and 11 2.5-inch SAS drives, 1.8 terabyte each. And I'm going to take you to the process I took when I was designing my Zpools. So please show some support, like this video if it helps you, and subscribe to my channel. So let's go and design my TrueNAS Zpools. Okay, now the first thing we are going to do is we're going to think about what type of data we're going to be storing on our TrueNAS box. And let's full screen this. So in my case, there'll be family videos and pictures. These YouTube videos will be stored locally. I'm going to be running some databases like Postgres and MySQL. And we'll be talking about ZFS tuning for that once I set those up. I'm going to be setting up some VMs. We're going to be taking some system or device backups that I have in the house. We are also going to set up Plex media server so that I can stream my media. And then I'm going to be setting up Nextcloud. I will then be setting up some NFS mounts so that I can pass them on to VMs for persistent storage. iSCSI is, I think for now, I'm only thinking for 2 use cases. One is for databases, and the other one is if I am going to do some cloud gaming and going to store some of the games, and then some maybe data sets for Kubernetes persistent storage. So these were the main data types I want to store. And next we need to look at the IOPS requirement for these data types. So for Postgres and MySQL databases that require higher IOPS, and we'll talk about a little what IOPS are. For Plex media server, it needs low IOPS, but it requires higher sequential reads. For persistent storage for Kubernetes, it mixed, really depends on what they are doing and what type of data they're storing. System backups require low IOPS, hosting websites and blogs. So I do host my own website, and that is running on top of one of my Kubernetes cluster. So that require low IOPS. Then I'm going to be creating some VMs and containers in Proxmox, and that requires higher IOPS. And that's what I was talking about, the iSCSI block storage. Then NFS mounts, again depends, it can be high or low IOPS as well, and then we talked about iSCSI as well. So hopefully that makes sense. So before we continue, let's define some of the things you need to understand when designing your Zpools. So the first up, hard disk or SSD sector. Basically, a sector represents the smallest read or write a disk can do in a single operation. That's your sector. Okay, it's the smallest storage unit. For example, my drives, I'm using a sector of 4 kilobytes, but I've seen some of the older drives which use 512 bytes or even 8 kilobytes on some of the SSDs. Another thing you need to remember is that a sector is caused by something called A shift. So my drives are using a default A shift of 12, and 2 to the power of 12 would give you 4096, which is 4K per sector. So RAID Z1, 2, or 3 is pretty much the number of parity drives you have set up in your Zpool. RAID Z1 has 1 parity disk, 2 has 2, and 3 has 3 parity disks. So for best performance on random read-write operations, use a small number of disks in each RAID Z group. So for example, 3 disk RAID Z1, or 6 disk RAID Z2, or 9 disk RAID Z3. This is because RAID Z actually spreads each logical block across all the devices, meaning you can lose any of the drives and your data will still be there. So in RAID Z1, you can lose 1 drive, RAID Z2, you can lose 2 drives, RAID Z3, you can lose 3 drives. But there is one key thing you need to bear in mind is, if you opting only a simple RAID Z group, it's going to give you a performance of less than a single disk in the group. So if you want to double your write IOPS, you would need to halve the number of disks in that RAIDZ group. Or if you want to double your read IOPS, you would need to halve the number of data disks, meaning total disk minus your parity disk in the RAIDZ group. Okay, so for example, in a RAIDZ 2, you can go from 12 to 7 disks and it will boost performance. A zVol and dataset, I'm gonna discuss it together. So what is a dataset and what is a zVol? So zVol are block storage, whereas your datasets are file systems. So zVol is typically used with iSCSI, and you can pass it to a VM. It will treat it as if a physical drive was attached to it. Whereas a dataset is typically used with Samba Share or SIF Shares. You typically mount the dataset in a VM like a network drive because it's a file system. There is another big difference between the two. If you're using zVols, there will be something called a padding overhead, which is a hidden cost of using zVols, because you'll be using something called a vol block size, and the vol block size is gonna affect the performance as well as it's gonna bring the padding overhead as well. You can only set your vol block size at the time of creation of your zVol, and you cannot change that later on. So if you choose a small vol block size, your padding overhead is gonna be massive, and you are essentially forced to choose a bigger vol block size. So the TrueNAS default zVol vol block size is 16K, but if you to increase it to 32K, the performance will be bad, and they are not suitable for your databases. So you have to set up according to your use case what the vol block size should be. So if, for example, you're running Postgres database, some experts says Postgres usually writes at 8 kilobyte per vol block size, and you can set it up. But if you try and do that within the TrueNAS UI, it gives you a warning. It says, no, you should select it to 16 kilobyte. But 16 kilobyte vol block size is fine for MySQL database or other databases. Oracle can also use 4K vol block size. And if you're running a VM with ext4 or even NTFS, it doesn't matter what the workload is, ext4 will always write with 4K chunks, as will the NTFS. From my experience, you cannot change the vol block size, or you cannot set it up using the TrueNAS UI, so you have to use command line for that. And once that is set, you can make sure that it's been set accordingly. You can use the command zfs get vol block size and then your zvol name, and it will show you what the underlying vol block size is. So parity. So in ZFS, there is no dedicated parity drive like in Unraid, but instead stores parity across all the drives in the VDEV. So the amount of parity that is spread across the drives determines your level of RAIDZ, whether you're using RAIDZ 1, 2, or 3. IOPS, again, input-output operations per second. So it's a performance measurement for your drives. So higher the IOPS, higher the performance; lower the IOPS, lower the performance. Okay, padding overhead. This only applies to your zVols. These do not concern your datasets. And this is the hidden cost because ZFS will not show it anywhere. Your zVols will be bigger in size than they actually need to be. So that's how you are consuming more storage, usable storage, when you're creating your zVols. If you choose the default 4K or 8K vol block size, then the padding overhead gonna be massive, and you're forced to choose a higher vol block size, which are really bad for your databases or running your VMs. So these were some of the terms that we had to understand before we move on to finding out what a hidden padding overhead could be if you're using zVols. So let's do that. So I came across this article written by Matthew Ahrens on Delphix. I'll leave a link in the description. And he very helpfully created a spreadsheet for us to understand how a hidden cost actually affects your zVol capacity. So I opened it up here. So how you understand is these are your number of disks in your RAIDZ 1 pool. And this is for RAIDZ 2, this is for RAIDZ 3. So I'm just going to give you one quick example for RAIDZ 1. Here, these are your number of sectors for your drives. So as I said, my drives use 4K sector. So one here means 4K, 2 means 8K of vol block size, 3 mean 12 vol block size, 4 means 16, and so on. So here, you can see if, let's say, you have a 7 disks in a RAIDZ 1 group and you are using a default 16 kilobyte vol block size. So on top of your parity loss, you will also have some padding loss as well. So I expanded his spreadsheet and calculated how that might be. So let's open that. So let's pick up one example. Let's do this one, for example. So if you have 11 disks in RAID Z1, which you shouldn't be doing, but if you just need ginormous space and you have number of disks 11, RAID Z1 you're using. In RAID Z1, you have one parity disk only. Drive storage capacity, that's 1.8 terabyte for each disk. Total gives me 19.8, so that's simply number of disks times drive storage capacity. So that's 19.8. Parity loss is 9% because you can count the parity 1 over the number of drives. And then if you take that away from 9% is the parity loss. And I'm looking at 64K. So we go back here, 11 disks, 64K is 16 sectors. And you take away 9 minus 11, and that will give you a padding loss of 2%, yeah, which is correct. And total is 11%. So if I go with that, your Z-wall size will be 2% more than what it needs to be. So in this instance, for example, here, if I go with 11 disks in RAID Z2 at 8K wall block size, my Z-wall size will not be 100%, it will be 245%, which is huge. And if I go next, it gives you, so if I'm using 100% space, I'm just creating data sets, I will be able to use 12.96. And the reason is that because you need to keep 20% free of your capacity, otherwise ZFS will not like it and goes into panic mode. And if I only create Z-walls, I'm just gonna be using 5.28 terabyte of the total space. So from 19.8, the only usable space for me will be 5.28. And then there are some other things, you know, how the write or read sequential read throughput are affected and how many disks that may fail. So I created this using different topologies. What if I run only 8 disks striped mirror? What if I only have 7 disks in RAID Z1? Again, you don't need to worry if you're only using data sets. That's if you are using Z-walls. That's when it matters. Okay, so this is the hidden cost. There are other calculators I came across online. This is one. You can set up how many disks you have and it basically also takes you through to the calculation walkthrough. This is really helpful and you can find out using this command in TrueNAS the sector size of your drive and things like that. And on TrueNAS website they also talked about the 6 measurements you can use to performance manage your ZFS pool, and I will leave these in the description as well. So based on all this, what we've discussed, let me give you a quick example of how padding can also affect your performance of your Z pool. So let's go back to my slides. Okay, so let's play this. So here is the problem that you might run in. So let's say you want to read 8 kilobyte of data for 1,000 times. So that's the problem. And here is your 8 kilobyte of data. However, at the time of creating the Z pool, you selected the 32K wall block size. So essentially, what's going to happen is you're not going to be reading just the 8K. You will be reading 32K wall block size for your 8K. So basically, 1/4 of the performance you get in. And the other thing is, you just want to read 8K, but you are actually reading 4 times more data that you actually need to. So again, performance hit. But in reality, what's going to happen is because I'm using a shift of 12, so I don't have 8K block sizes, I have 4K block sizes. So this 8K will be divided into 2 4K blocks, and each 4K block will read 32K wall block size. And this means, so you have 32K wall block size for each 4K blocks times 2 because you have 2 blocks and you want to read it for 1,000 times, that will trigger 8,000 block operations. So ideally, you should be reading only 2 times, yeah, instead of 32K, you should be reading 4K. And that should only be 2000 block operations, but you're doing 8000 block operations. Your performance is just 25%. Okay, so that's how wall block size can also hit your performance. Now, based on all these examples, that's how I created my Zpools. So I have 5 800 GB enterprise SSDs, and I also have 11 1.8 terabyte enterprise SAS drives at 12 gigabits per second. So I created three pools. So this is my Zpool or RAID Z1 pool, but this is just for capacity purposes. So I'm gonna be using my Samba shares, SIF shares, Apple Time Machine backups. I'm gonna dumping all the family videos and pictures, Nextcloud data. I've run my own GitLab instance as well, system backups. So it requires low IOPS anyway. So that's for that. So then I have these five SSDs. Out of these five, I'm gonna be using four because I went for striped mirrors. So meaning four drives, two VDEVs striped together. So I'm getting double the speed. So this is purely for if I'm running any Proxmox VMs or if I am gonna be running databases. So for example, if I'm using wall block size of 8K, that's perfect for Postgres. MySQL and Microsoft SQL, they are okay with using 16K block. And if you are running a VM with EXT4 or NTFS for Windows, it doesn't matter what the workload is, EXT4 will always write 4K chunks, and obviously as will the NTFS. If you're running VMware, VDI, I think it's typically around 24 to 32K, and it's accessed via iSCSI or FC. So this is the purpose of this striped mirror pool. Remaining four 1.8 terabyte drives, I also created another striped mirror, but because I had a spare enterprise SSD, I added it as a ZIL to boost performance. So this is where I could use my MySQL databases, or even again some iSCSI storage for Windows VM, where I could dump some of the games, and I can also create some of the Kubernetes persistence storage on this as well. Hopefully it will give you an overview how you can design yours. Let's go back to the studios. All the numbers that I calculated in this video are theoretical and based on the formulas how ZFS should behave, but there could be a number of other reasons that could affect the usable capacity and performance of your Zpools. For example, what block sizes your SSDs are using, which no manufacturer will tell you in their data sheets that I know of. What type of compression you're using, what ratio of datasets and Zvols you're using. Are you using deduplication? How good is your data and how good it is for compression? So these are all the factors that could affect the performance and usable capacity for your Zpools. Hopefully this video will help you design yours. Please leave a comment below and share your Zpool design with us. In the next video, I'll be installing TrueNAS Core. I'll see you there.